Hi, this is Pastor Barb. It's always such a joy to welcome you to worship with us here on our YouTube channel for Covenant Presbyterian DTC. Our time together in worship is so important right now. Our nation is in upheaval. Our world is still trying to conquer this deadly virus. And worship can ground us. It can bring us back to our center in Christ, remind us of how loved we are by God and how God is still involved in our world, even when things seem so messed up and so dire. We're in a sermon series on the kingdom of God, which is so timely because we remember that God's kingdom is so very different from the kingdom we live in on this earth. It's better. It's about abundance and kindness and love and healing. So I invite you now to enter in this time of worship to ground yourself and open your heart up to God's kingdom. Let's join in our call to worship. No matter how far we wander from you, O God, your steadfast love finds us. No matter how unjust this world seems to us, O God, your steadfast righteousness sustains us. No matter how vulnerable our lives seem to us, O God, your steadfast presence gives us hope. No matter how unloved or uncared for we feel, O God, you hear our cries and answer our prayers. Thanks be to God. Let's worship together.
Everyone, and welcome to another Grow Curriculum Lesson Series. We are here this week, and you can't see me, can you? How about this? Whoa, there we go. You know, this week has got me pumped up about light. That's what our lesson's going to be on today. And, you know, being in the dark can be scary. Like not being able to see or just feeling things that you don't know what you're touching. And this is really well demonstrated by the cast of Star Wars. They go onto Vanity Fair and play a game called What's in the Box. Take a watch.
I don't know why you're looking at me. I don't know why you're looking at me right now.
Some of the things I've done in my career I've thought really dangerous. Nothing is compared to what's in the box.
Nothing does.
I don't like it, but I'm... It's so horrifying.
I don't know why they've done this to you. I don't know why they've done it.
I can't tell when you're being...
Just do what you need to
John, do. John, don't look at me like that, just because that look...
You just use your palm and go and just press.
Are you doing me over here?
No, I'm not.
Will you hold my hand while I do it?
All right, let's go. Come on. Yeah, just, and then down.
Are you serious?
More down, yeah. Just press down. Just down. Bit more. No.
Is it a frog? Is it a marble? It's a marble and I look like a fool. Welcome to What's in the Box. You too can look like a fool with a marble.
When you need more clarity on it. Well, you got this. What could it possibly be?
What's in the box? Is it gonna kill me?
Lower. Keep on going, love. I got you. Just keep on going. Just lay it.
I'm going to need...
Keep on going and then lay it just still so you can just get a feel for what that is. Yeah, just lay it on it. Yeah, and that's it. That's it. There we go.
All right. Now, to be fair, what you didn't see is that they put an actual live snake in her box before. So it really could have been anything in that box. No reason. I would have been scared too. And you know, being in the dark can be scary. But you know what's really cool is that the psalmist, the person who wrote today's psalm, knows this and talks about it. And so we're going to read Psalm 119, and we're going to read verses, let me get it out. We're going to read verses 101 to 105, and it goes like this. I hold back my feet from every evil way in order to keep your word. I do not turn aside from your rules, for you have taught me. How sweet are your words to my taste, sweeter than honey. Through your precepts I get understanding, therefore I hate every false way. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Wow, I really love that line. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. You see, life is scary when it's lived in darkness, not knowing what's coming next. You've probably faced this as well. It can be scary being in the dark about maybe going to a new school and what to expect. Will I like the teachers? Will I make new friends? Will I pass my classes? Being in the dark about maybe going to a birthday party of a kid you don't know too well. Will it be fun? Will I be cool? Will he be cool? I don't know. Or maybe being in the dark about trying some new foods. Why does this lump of rice have raw fish on it? Will it make me sick? Well, our lesson today is that we can be confident in ourselves and our surroundings because God leads us. God is the lamp to our feet and the light to our path. So when maybe you're feeling a little scared about the next things coming up in your life that you feel you're in the dark about, turn to God. Go to God in prayer or look for some encouraging words in the Bible. Or turn to the people God has put in your life. Because when we do that, the path forward will always be lit. Peace and blessings, church.
Our weekly time of confession is our time to come before God, really to confess our need for God, how hard it is to do this on our own. I know that sometimes the words of our prayers might just not speak to you, and sometimes they may be exactly what you need. So I invite you now to open your heart to the words of this prayer and enter into a time together where we let God know how much in need we are. Let us pray. Source of all life, we confess that we have not allowed your grace to set us free. We fear that we're not good enough. We hear your word of love freely given to us, yet we expect others to earn it. We turn the church inward rather than moving it outward. Forgive us and stir us. Reform us to be a church powered by love, willing to speak for what is right, act for what is just, and seek the healing of your whole creation. Amen. Friends, God always hears our cry and sends the Spirit to change us and empower our lives in the world. Our sins are forgiven. God's love is unconditional, and we are raised up as God's people who will always be made new in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Jesus, friend of sinners, we have strayed so far away. We cut down people in your name, but the sword was never ours to swing. Jesus, friend of sinners, the truth's become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around, but never looking up. I'm so double-minded. A plank-eyed saint with dirty hands and a heart divided. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy, help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Stones fall from their hands. Help us to remember we are all the least of these. Let the memory of your mercy bring your people to their knees.
Nobody knows what we're for, only what we're against when we judge the wounded. What if we put down our signs, crossed over the lines, and love like you did? Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. You love every lost cause. You reach for the outcast, for the leper and the lame. They're the reason that you came. Lord, I was that lost cause. and I was the outcast. But you died for sinners just like me, a grateful leper at your feet. 'Cause you are good, you are good, and your love endures forever. You are good, you are good, and your love endures forever. You are good, you are good, and your love endures forever. You are good, you are good, and your love endures forever. Sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. And I was the lost cause, and I was the outcast. Yeah. You died for sinners just like me, a grateful leper at your feet.
I absolutely love the two stories from the life of Jesus we're looking at today, because in these two stories, Jesus shows us exactly what his priorities are and gives us a glimpse of the priorities of the kingdom of God. For Jesus, human welfare is a priority. And let's even dare to say human flourishing. For Jesus, the person always comes first. And for Jesus, human need poses a moral imperative. It is always the right time to do good. These two stories go together. They're in Mark chapter 2, and they follow one another, and they have a similar theme. And the theme is Jesus flagrantly disregarding religious rules in order to help a human flourish. So this first story in Mark chapter 2, it is a Sabbath day. And you may remember that there were ad nauseum rules in the first century about how to keep the Sabbath. There's one Old Testament commandment, remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. But the rabbis developed 39 categories of what it meant to keep the Sabbath day holy and to rest. And from those 39 categories, we have hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of rules. Rules to keep on the Sabbath, like how far you can walk, what you cannot do. Well, one of the rules was to not harvest. You can't reap anything. So here's the story. On the Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields, and as they, that's Jesus and his disciples, as they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain. Now, this was not breaking any rules. It was lawful for a traveler to get food in the forms of picking some grain as they traveled through the fields on their journey. Perfectly okay. It was a way of being neighborly, loving your neighbor. That's not what they got called out on. The Pharisees, and you remember, the Pharisees were the religious leaders. They were wealthy, and they made their living and based their reputation on keeping all the religious laws. That was their deal. So the Pharisees, the rule keepers, said to Jesus, "Look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath?" You see, they were harvesting. They were reaping grain as they walked through to eat. Well, Jesus said to them, "Have you never read what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food?" So he brings up this Old Testament reference where King David, you know, the best king of all, did something very, very similar. They were hungry and they went into the temple and ate the consecrated bread. And it was an example that the person comes first. So Jesus says, "Haven't you heard what David did when they were hungry? He entered the house of God when Abiathar was high priest and ate the bread of the presence, which is not lawful for any but the priest to eat. And David gave some to his companions." Then Jesus said to them, "The Sabbath was made for humankind, not humankind for the Sabbath. And the Son of Man," meaning himself, "the Son of Man is Lord even of the Sabbath." Jesus, flagrantly disregarding religious law so that his followers could eat. They were journeying, they were hungry, they were in a field. It was a Sabbath, and Jesus let them eat. Because human flourishing is a part of the kingdom of God, feeding the hungry. Sometimes rules hold back human flourishing. Now, the second scripture comes right after this. They're paired really nicely. It's also a Sabbath day. Again, Jesus entered the synagogue, which was the place of worship and teaching. A man was there who had a withered hand, so probably a deformity, a paralyzation, something. They watched. So the Pharisees were the they, but really the whole room. They watched to see whether he would cure him on the Sabbath so that they might accuse him. Because guess what? It wasn't okay to heal or administer medical aid on the Sabbath unless someone was dying. In fact, there was even this explanation. Here's a situation where if a building collapsed, you could remove enough rubble, because that was work and lifting. You could remove enough rubble to see if there were any survivors, but if there were bodies that had perished, you had to leave the bodies until the Sabbath day was over. So these really strict rules about how you could help people. So they're watching him to see if he's going to do anything for this guy with the deformed hand. So Jesus called out to the man who had the withered hand and said, "Come forward." Now you could imagine what was going through this guy's head. You know, to be disabled in that era probably meant you were poor or a beggar, ostracized, ridiculed. And here was Jesus calling you forward in the middle of a Sabbath synagogue crowd. So he calls the guy forward and then he addresses the room. "Is it lawful to do good or to do harm on the Sabbath? To save life or to kill?" And they were silent. Nobody said a word. He looked around at them with anger. He was grieved at their hardness of heart and said to the man, "Stretch out your hand." He stretched it out and his hand was restored. The Pharisees went out and immediately conspired with the Herodians, another religious group, against Jesus and how to destroy him. In the kingdom of God, people are first. In the kingdom of God, people flourish because doing good is always a priority. Because for Jesus, human need posed a moral imperative. Where good needs to be done, for Jesus, there was no neutrality. Failure to do good is contributing to evil. So for Jesus, it wasn't just permissible to heal on the Sabbath, it was right to heal on the Sabbath. It was the right thing to do. The Pharisees were totally caught up in just fulfilling religious stipulations, and they forgot what the heart of God is. The heart of God is for God's people to flourish, to be healed, to be fed. For Jesus, these things were his priority. Jesus' heart cannot remain unmoved in the face of suffering. This is the kingdom of God. So remember, the kingdom of God in Scripture, in the 175 times this word is used in the New Testament, it never means where we go when we die. It never means pie in the sky, something for we're waiting for when Jesus returns. It never means the church or the church's activities. The kingdom of God is something we enter right here, right now, when we are ready to enter into a new way of being. And in these scriptures, we see the new way of being in God's kingdom is doing good all the time, regardless of what the rules say. The person comes first. So as we grow in our faith, it's my hope that we will enter in to this new way of being so that we are always ready to act on behalf of another person, and that it will also be our moral touchstone to remind us it's not always about the rules, it's always about the person. Isn't that what we need right now in our country and in our world? You know, I want to share a couple things from my life, not by means of saying, yay me, but my means of sharing when Christ is dwelling in our hearts. It can help open our eyes and be ready to always put the other person first, because we're his representatives, right? If we're citizens of God's kingdom, we're representing what Jesus would do and be in the world. Early in the pandemic, Pierre and I met some friends downtown when restaurants were still open, and it was a bitter cold. It was a really cold day. And we were down there at Sam's Number 2, which is right by the convention center, and it was surprisingly busy, and there was a long wait, and it was freezing, and you know, we were all social distancing. Well, a block away was a Starbucks, and we thought it was about an hour wait, and we had all driven, you know, to rendezvous with these friends. So we walked down to the Starbucks just to get something to warm us up. And of course, there was nowhere to sit at the Starbucks. Everybody was just pulling up tables and chairs to prevent gathering. And so we all got our hot coffee, and we were heading back down to Sam's to wait in line under the heat lamp. And Pierre and our two friends were walking in front of me, and we all had our coffee. And there was a, you know, where we're downtown, there was a very scruffy homeless man just leaning against the window at the Starbucks. And I was a little bit behind. And as Pierre and our friends walked by, I watched his eyes follow their coffee cups. And there wasn't even a thought that crossed my mind. There was no thinking involved. As I walked by, my hand, I hadn't touched my coffee yet. I just instinctively handed him my latte. And it was a kingdom of God moment. I don't want to be sound all braggy. What I want is to capture that moment when we realize that God within us actually makes a difference in how we live. There was another time recently where I had just picked up my dog at the groomers, and I always get him a nice big chunky bone to chew on. They have these awesome natural, it was like a femur, I think, of something. And I was pulling out of the parking lot. There was another homeless guy with his sign, and he had a dog that was lying there. I don't carry a lot of cash anymore. It's just, you know, we're a credit card society, right? But I was stopped at the stop sign, and I had a dog bone, and he had a homeless dog, and I just rolled down the window. I said, I'm sorry, I have this for your dog. and he was over the moon. He was over the moon. Little moments. I'm not solving homelessness, but I'm giving a little glimpse of the kingdom of God to people who need that glimpse, who need to know that God cares about human flourishing. It's important. I read a news article just today about a waitress at a little restaurant down in Florida, and this family came in, and it was a mom and dad and a little boy and an even littler girl. And as she watched this family, she noticed how gruff they were with the little boy. And when they ordered food, they didn't order food for him. And so the waitress started to pay attention, and she noticed that his arms were bruised, and not just fresh bruises, like old bruises with new bruises on top of them. And she felt this growing sense of concern for him. So she wrote a little note, and she kind of went around behind the parents where they could not see her, but he could. And the note said, "Do you need help?" And she showed him the note, and he kind of, you know, looked away and shook his head. But then she noticed him start to watch her and kind of look at her and try and catch her eye. So she wrote another note and walked over and held it up. "Do you need help?" And he gave her a signal. So she called the owner of the restaurant, who said, "Yes, call the police." And she did. And they discovered that this couple had been literally torturing this poor boy in their home. They were arrested. They have charges filed against them now. He and his sister have been removed and are happily together in a foster home. But this waitress, right? Sometimes it takes a risk to stand for human flourishing, to not shrink back and say, "Well, you know, maybe I'm misunderstanding something." She took a risk to put another human being first and help that little boy get out of that home and into a place where, oh my gosh, we hope that he can flourish. It's integrating the kingdom of God into our very being, making it a part of who we are, so that every minute of the day we are ready. We're ready to act as citizens of that kingdom, act as Jesus would. We have a moral imperative to put human needs first. By not doing good, we're supporting evil. I love what our food pantry has done. This pandemic hit, and they figured out another way to feed people because they believe in human flourishing. And like the disciples picking those heads of grain, people need to eat in order to flourish. They just developed a whole new pandemic system. People don't get to come in and shop for their food anymore, but they pull up in their cars, and those faithful volunteers load boxes of food into their trunks with really limited human contact. They found a way to be the kingdom of God and help people flourish in the midst of this pandemic. Friends, let's enter the kingdom together. Let's enter into a new way of being that puts people first, that participates in the good, that doesn't judge people based on what rules they're keeping or breaking, but judges based on the good that's happening. May God bless you. I want you this week to look for glimpses of the kingdom of God that you see in your life and in the news. I want to hear about them. God bless you.
Hi everyone, Jack here. Happy Sunday. Let's worship and praise the Lord this morning with In Christ Alone. So here it goes. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest traveling storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are steeled and striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. His gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. In the death of Christ I live. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my death. Power of hell, no scheme of men can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Have a great week.
This moment in our worship is a reminder to you that our offerings are a part of our worship. The offerings of ourselves to God's service and our financial gifts. As we have been blessed, we are asked to be a blessing and to return a portion of what we earn to the work of God through our church. So friends, let's give with gratitude. It's a new year. And we have so much to look forward to. Amen. And so as we close our time together, please receive this benediction. Remember that wherever you are, God is with you. Wherever you go, it's God who sends you. Christ, who dwells in you, has something he wants you to do because of where you are. Remember this and go in his grace and love and power. Amen.